Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start our current affairs. So today you have 17th of March 2021. Okay, and we are going to start with our current affairs. As you know that these lectures are basically uploaded on the YouTube channel. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for these current affairs related lectures on the day-to-day basis. And these lectures are basically are very useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examination, because you require to answer the few questions related to the current affairs also. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is basically related to the air pollution. Okay, now you know that the air pollution is basically is the most important threat now the humanity is facing, because almost in every country the air pollution is basically a big problem. That because of the air pollution, you know, lot of other associated problems are also coming. For example, the average global temperature is rising. Okay, the human health is also getting impacted, right? The flora and the fauna is also getting impacted because of the air pollution, right? The climatic changes, environmental changes are occurring on the earth. So lot of other, you know, changes are occurring, and this air pollution, which is increasing with that pace, is because of the anthropogenic reasons. So anthropogenically the air pollution is impacting. Okay, so the anthropogenic sources like the emission of the greenhouse gases from, you know, from various sources, like you have, you know, like exhaust from the basically your automobiles, cars, scooters, buses, right? As well as the industrial development from the industries, all such has led to the air pollution. Okay, now, you know, a report was published, okay, which is on the global air pollution, which was released by the IQ Air, which is nothing but a Swiss air quality technology company. Okay, this Swiss air quality technology company is basically specializing the protection against the airborne pollutant, specifically the airborne pollutant may be the particulate matter, right? So this company has brought the global air pollution report, right, on the world basis, and which is also, you know, developing the air quality monitoring and air cleaning products also. So the key finding of such global air pollution report, which was given by the IQ Air, which is nothing but the Swiss air quality technology company. So the key findings are: the New Delhi, which is the capital of India, is the most polluted capital city in the world. Okay, it is the most polluted capital city. But if you compare India, or if you compare, you know, basically its particulate matter 2.5, okay, the India's position with respect to the annual average particulate matter 2.5, okay, the condition has improved since 2019, but still the India is the third most air polluted country in the world. Okay, and the Delhi is the most polluted capital city in the world in the report which is published by IQ Air. Okay, the India is the third most polluted country in the world, okay, in 2020. Okay, and the air is the fifth most noxious, right, in the world. The first two countries where the air quality is worse than India are the Bangladesh and the Pakistan. These two countries ranked first and second in 2020, right, for the worst average particulate matter 2.5 labels. Okay, so the Bangladesh and Pakistan both have scored lowest in terms of the, you know, worst air quality parameters in terms of the average particulate matter 2.5 concentration. Regarding China, the China ranks 11th position in the report, right? So the China's rank, if you compare with 2019 rank, its rank deteriorated from the 14th position, which was there in the 2019, to 11th position. That means its air quality has deteriorated, right, since 2019. Okay, regarding the cities, for example, Hotan in China are the most populated, most polluted city, okay, where the average concentration is 110.2 micrograms per meter cube regarding particulate matter 2.5, okay, and it is followed by the Ghaziabad, okay, in the Uttar Pradesh, which is having, you know, the average concentration of the particulate matter is 106 micrograms per meter cube. And this report shows that out of 15 most polluted cities in the world, 13 such cities are located in India. So that is how this problem is very severe, because 13 such cities are located in India. Okay. Now, in 2020 report, which was given by IQAir, which is a Swiss company, right, which says that 106 countries are evaluated based on the parameters. Okay. The pollution levels are basically weighted average, right? That means the population of the country influence the pollution values are also reported, okay? Because it's anthropogenically, you know, the pace at which the pollution is increasing is impacting the country, not only in India, but also throughout the world. So it is because of the anthropogenic regions, the pace at which the pollution levels are increasing. Okay. In 2020, 84% of all monitoring countries observed the air quality improvement. Okay, that is also a good news, that 84% of all the monitored, you know, countries basically shows that there is an improvement in their air quality, right? And only 24 met the World Health Organization's annual guideline for 2.5. Okay, so remaining countries have to be met, right? This guidelines, which is related to the particulate matter 2.5. Okay, so the world should cooperate and should reduce the particulate matter 2.5 in order to cut down these emissions, right, from the anthropogenic sources. Then only the world can be more cleaner and healthier. This is the rank you can see here, right? This is a score. So first is rank Bangladesh, which is the most polluted country in terms of the worst air quality, okay, in terms of particulate matter 2.5, right? The second is Pakistan, third is India, fourth is Mongolia, fifth is Afghanistan. These are the top five countries which are having the worst air quality parameter in terms of the particulate matter 2.5, right? All right, next, the rule curve. Okay, so there is some background I will tell you. See, there is dam called Mulla Periyar Dam. Okay, this Mulla Periyar Dam is located basically in Kerala, but it is regulated and maintained by Tamil Nadu. Okay, it is based on some lease agreement that was signed between the colonial rulers, right, between, you know, the princely states. Now, since the place of the dam is in Kerala, but it is regulated and maintained by the Tamil Nadu, right? So what happens is there was continuous fight between the Tamil Nadu and the Kerala regarding the fluctuation of the level of the dam. Tamil Nadu want that more water should be stored in the Mulla Periyar Dam. Kerala sees that if it is broken, right, its downstream portion of the Kerala will be completely wiped off because of flooding and all sort of incidents, okay? So the both Tamil Nadu and Kerala went to the Supreme Court, and then Supreme Court appointed the supervisory committee for management of this Mulla Periyar Dam. Okay. Now recently what is happening is that this rule curve is basically nothing but the fluctuating storage level. So this rule curve in the dam, right, it is a technical term where the fluctuating storage level in the reservoir is decided based on this rule curve. Okay, now the Supreme Court held the Chief Secretary of Tamil Nadu, right, to personally responsible and to take appropriate action, right, on the failure if he does not provide information on the rule curve, okay, right, and that is something to be provided to the Supreme Court appointed advisory committee or supervisory committee. Okay, so the rule curve, which is in the dam, is something is related to the storage level, okay, of the reservoir. Now, there are a lot of important aspects related to this rule curve. For example, the schedule for the gate opening and the closing is done based on this rule curve. Okay, so when to open, when not to open is based on this rule curve, which is nothing but the fluctuating storage level in the reservoir. Okay. And it is a part of the dam safety regulations. So it is a part of the core safety mechanism of the dam. Okay. Regarding Mulla Periyar Dam, as I told you, it is the masonry gravity dam, which is built at the confluence of the two rivers, that is Mullayar and Periyar rivers. Okay. The dam is located in the Kerala, but it is operated and maintained by the Tamil Nadu. This is the most important. Now, this dam, which is known as Mulla Periyar Dam, is constructed between 1887 and 1895 by John Pennycook, right? And there was an agreement at that point of the time, okay, to divert some water eastward towards the Madras Presidency area, right? At that point of the time, and that was currently known as, or that is currently known as Tamil Nadu. So there was some agreement which was signed at that point of the time between the two princely states, right? Now what happens is between two states and, you know, and that was the time when the water was diverted towards the Madras, right? Madras Presidency, right? Under this agreement, and there was continuous bone of contention between the Kerala and Tamil Nadu based on this agreement. Okay, so you can see here, this is the state boundary of Kerala and this is Tamil Nadu. Okay, the location of the dam is this red color, which is the Kerala or within the, you know, the territorial boundary of Kerala, but it is operated and maintained by the Tamil Nadu. Okay, so this is based on certain agreement which was signed between the two states. Okay, next. The World Energy Transitions Outlook, that is 1.5 degrees Celsius pathway. Okay, so this World Energy Transitions Outlook is basically a report. It's basically a report which was given by the International Renewable Energy Agency. Okay, so International Renewable Energy Agency, you know, released a report which is known as World Energy Transition Outlook. Okay, now regarding the highlight of this report, right, you must understand that it was started or it was previewed as a virtual Berlin Energy Transition Dialogue, right, which was started from March 16th, 2021. Okay, now obviously this report would certainly provide the outlook related to the energy transition, right, to, you know, to the non, to the renewable energy sources, from the non-renewable energy sources. So obviously the report proposes the energy transition solutions, right, for, you know, for basically from the non-renewable energy sources to the renewable energy sources. So it will show you the pathway so that you can contain the rise of the temperature to 1.5 degrees Celsius by the end of this century. Okay, now the report further says that the COVID-19 pandemic has slowed down the economy. Now it has also gave the unexpected opportunity to the world countries, right, to, you know, to decouple the economy. Decouple means to have the transition from the dependency from, you know, from the non-renewable sources like thermal energy, right, the coal energy, to basically some of the renewable energy sources like, you know, solar energy, wind energy, right, other renewable source of energy. All right. And it is estimated by this report that by 2050, 90% of the total electricity needs would be supplied by renewable energy sources. So that is the good, you know, prospect, right, given by International Renewable Energy Agency. Okay. And that will be followed by 6% from the natural gas and remaining from the nuclear energy. So 90%, according to that report, 90% of the energy would be generated from the renewable sources. Okay. Now the agency has identified 30 innovations for the integration of wind and solar photovoltaic in the power systems. That means these 30 innovations would definitely improve the share of renewable energy sources in the total energy basket in the world. Okay. So it is the International Renewable Energy Agency provides the World Energy Transition Outlook, right? A pathway to contain the rise of temperature to the 1.3 degrees Celsius by the end of this century. Okay. Next. the development financial institutions. Now you must understand these DFI or development finance institutions are basically, you know, institutions which provide the much needed funding source, right, to the infrastructural projects. Now these developmental financial institutions are already there. Now the Union Cabinet has decided to clear a bill, okay, to set up these developmental financial institutions. Now this DFI will be set up by the Government of India as a fully owned institution. That means they are completely owned by the Government of India, fully owned initially, okay? And such developmental financial institutions will have the initial paid up capital of 20,000 crore, right? Obviously for providing the much needed funding for the infrastructural projects. Okay, now the government can leverage around 3 trillion rupees from the market with the help of these developmental financial institutions, okay? Because certain funds will be tapped with the help of these DFIs, okay? And that will provide certain attractive offer to those funds, okay? So obviously such 3 trillion, you know, rupees that will be tapped from the markets, right, to provide the long-term funds, because long-term funding is something which is needed specifically in the infrastructure projects, because, you know, the completion of the project basically took the long time, sometimes. So the long-term funding will be most essential for the infrastructure projects. Okay, that is gestation period of the project, okay, for the developmental need of the country. And beside, the government also give the 5,000 crore rupees as a grant to the institutions which are providing such avenues, okay? But that grant which will be provided by the Government of India would be as a tax saving bonds which will be provided to the institutions. Now the amount that will provide for hedging the cost, right? If the DFI or developmental financial institutions borrows from some of the multilateral or bilateral institutions, right? And that will also subsidize the guarantee fees also, okay? Now these developmental financial institutions would be initially the government owned, right? And subsequently the promoter stake will be brought down, okay? So now initially that will be fully owned Government of India's entity. At the later point of the time, within next few years, the promoter's stake will be brought down to 26%. Okay. Now, the bill also mandated that, right, that at any point, the government will continue to hold 26% of the holding in such developmental financial institutions. All right. And in the bill also provide that the government will provide 10 years tax exemption to those fund, right, which invested in the developmental financial institutions to attract such funds, especially the insurance funds or pension funds, because such long-term funds are much needed, okay, much needed avenues for the infrastructural projects. So for development of infrastructural projects, we need the tapping of such funds, which are insurance funds or pension funds. Okay, you see here the national infrastructural pipeline. Okay, in the national infrastructural pipeline, what we have seen is that the number of projects which are already there in the fray, that is 7,671. The total cost that will be incurred in that is around $1,119 US billion, or around 111 trillion rupees. Okay. The duration for such project will be from 2019 onward to 2025. If you consider this breakup of these projects, the roads and the bridges consist of 2,625 projects, railway track consisting of 606 projects, urban public transport consisting of 220 projects, airport and aviation infrastructure consists of 91 projects, and port consists of 79 projects. Now, as you know that Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman, who is also the finance minister, you know, said that both development and financial objectives will be met, right, with the help of the setting up of these development and financial institutions. Okay, next, census. As you know, that census, first complete census, the first complete census, okay, was done, okay, in 1881. Since then, every 10 years, the census is carried out. That means the census was carried out in 2001, 2011, and it will be carried out in 2021 also. Now, this census data, which will be collected by the Government of India's agencies, now, this data is supposed to be captured or supposed to be conducted, the first phase of census, okay, from 1st April 2020. But you know that because of Corona or COVID-19 pandemic, right, such collection of the data related to the house listing, housing census was basically postponed, right? So, you know, the Union Home Ministry basically, you know, provided to the parliamentary committee that the provisional data for the latest census, okay, and national population register, which will be available before the Lok Sabha elections, right? So the Lok Sabha elections is due in 2024. So the Union Home Ministry says that the provisional data related to the latest census, as well as the national population register, which will be available well before the 2024 Lok Sabha elections. Okay. As you know that every 10 years there is a census. So the previous census was conducted in 2011. Okay. And it has the database of around 119 crore residents of the country. Okay. And this census or this data of 2011 census, which was last updated in 2015. All right. And as you know that the first phase of this census would have to be started from the 1st April 2020, but it was indefinitely postponed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, now it's going to start. All right. Now the provisional census result will be available or will be released in the financial year 2023-24. And you will also have the village level data on important indicators, right? It will be provided under primary census abstract. Okay. Now to collect the data related to the census, okay, a mobile application has been developed by the Government of India. This mobile application would basically collect the data or details related to census, okay, related to the national population register, right? And in that mobile application, the residents can also self enumerate, right, themselves, right? And this mobile application have, you know, regional languages also. So for collecting of the data with respect to the census, okay, this mobile app is available in 16 Indian regional languages. So that will be helpful in enumeration of the data with respect to the census. Okay. Next, the medical termination of the Pregnancy Amendment Bill 2020. Now, as you know that there is statutory provisions that provide when to conduct the abortion, right? When to conduct the abortion. So there is some time or some week time within which you can carry out the abortion, but you have to take the opinion of the doctor. Now, to leverage or to increase the time which is given under the previous law, right? The medical termination of the Pregnancy Amendment Bill 2020 was passed by the parliament. That means Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha both passed this medical termination of the Pregnancy Amendment Bill 2020. Now, the idea of this amendment bill is to increase the time period within which an abortion may be carried out. Okay. So it has the aspect of increasing of the time period within which the abortion will be carried out. Okay. Now, in the current statutory framework, if the abortion is to be done within 12 weeks of the conception, okay, now you need the opinion of one doctor for the abortion to be carried out if the time period is 12 weeks or time period is within 12 weeks of conception, right? If the abortion is carried out, if the time period of, of the conception is 12 to 20 weeks, now you have to take the opinion of two doctors. Now, this amendment bill basically allow to increase this, you know, the time period within which the abortion may be carried out. So now the bill provide that the abortion can be done on the advice of one doctor only up to 20 weeks. That means previously, right, the two doctors' opinion is needed for abortion to be carried out up to 12 weeks. But now the abortion can be carried out up to 20 weeks with the opinion of only single doctor. Okay. Now the opinion of the two doctors will be needed in certain categories of the women, which are the period of the weeks of the conception is between 20 to 24 weeks. That means up to 20 weeks, only one doctor's opinion is enough. And between 20 to 24 weeks, the opinion of the two doctors is needed. Okay. Now, the pregnancy to be terminated after 24 weeks, okay, you know, because of some sort of a substantial foetal anomalies or abnormalities, right, you need to take the permission from the state level medical board, that is. So that means up to 20 weeks, you need the permission or you need the approval from just one doctor. Okay. Then 20 to 24 weeks. Okay. You need the permission from two doctors or approval from the two doctors. And beyond 24 weeks. Okay. If that abortion is taking place, you have to take the opinion of the state level medical board. The state level medical board. Okay. The opposition parties or opposition MPs says that this bill basically, you know, did not give, you know, the freedom to the woman to decide regarding this abortion. Okay. Now, the note that is provided to the state level medical board related to the abortion is against the freedom which is being provided to the woman regarding such abortion beyond 24 weeks. The original bill was framed in 1971, which was related to the abortion or the termination of the medical, you know, pregnancy. All right. Next, the Oru-Nodoi scheme. What is this Oru-Nodoi scheme? See, Oru-Nodoi scheme is basically, you know, implemented by the BJP government, which is currently a ruling government in basically in the Assam state. So now there is state assembly elections due, as you know, probably. Okay. Now, the Oru-Nodoi scheme, which was, you know, related to the empowerment of the woman, because the primary target is women, or the primary target are women. So, it is the most popular scheme, which is being implemented by the BJP. So, in December 2020, right, the scheme was launched. Right. And it is basically the largest direct benefit transfer, that is DBT, direct benefit transfer scheme, right, in the history of Assam. Okay. That will definitely empower the women and serve the needy sections of the society. Okay. Through this Oru-Nodoi scheme, right, which is already announced by the government of Assam in its budget 2020-21, right, under this Oru-Nodoi scheme, right, a monthly assistance or financial assistance directly in the bank accounts of the beneficiary will be transferred, that too in the tune of 830 rupees per person. Okay. So, per family. So directly the monthly assistance will be transferred directly to the accounts of, you know, to the women, specifically to the marginalized sections of the society. Okay. So that will be transferred. Okay, it will be transferred directly to the marginalized sections of the society, which is basically also related to, you know, the empowerment of the woman, specifically from the marginal sections of the society. Okay, so this is what is something that you must understand. Okay, which is the most important aspect related to sections of the society. Okay, next. On the account of being direct benefit transfer, okay, which is being there, you know, as a direct benefit transfer scheme, okay, the money is directly credited to the bank account because it is the largest direct benefit transfer scheme, okay, which will be directly to be transferred in the bank accounts of the women beneficiaries. So this Oru-Nodoi scheme, which was implemented by the government of, you know, the government of Assam, because the elections are due in the state of Assam, and that scheme would be benefiting right the you know the sections of the society, specifically the women and the lower middle sections of the society, which will be benefiting out of such scheme. And under this scheme, 830 rupees per household level, right, would be provided directly to the account of the beneficiary of, you know, such scheme. Okay, so here you can see here, it is the largest DBT scheme or direct benefit transfer scheme in the state of Assam. Okay, the budget which will be, which is basically announced by the government of Assam in 2020-21 budget, it was around 2,800 rupees crore. Okay, the beneficiary household which will be covered under the scheme is around 18.20 lakhs. And mainly the woman beneficiary will be getting benefited, and it will be the woman empowerment program. Okay, it will benefit around 90 lakh population in the state of Assam, and it will be implemented in all the district, 33 districts, right, 2,277 gram panchayats, 229 blocks, villages, 27,927 villages will be covered, 100 urban areas will be covered, and you will also have, you know, the Sakhis will also be engaged in this scheme. Okay, next, the Jharkhand State Employment of the Local Candidate Bill 2021. Now, this is the recurring trend, which is basically there. See, after, you know, the state of Haryana, see, Haryana also, you know, passed this type of bill, which provide the reservation to the local people who belongs to the state of Haryana. Now, after Haryana, the Jharkhand government also planning to provide the 75% reservation specifically to the people who belongs to the Jharkhand, right, to the native people. Okay, and that is the salary up to 30,000 rupees, right? All such jobs which are having the salary up to 30,000 rupees, right, such jobs out of 100% seats, 75% seats should be reserved compulsory to those candidates who are belongs to the Jharkhand. Okay, now who are all the establishments or who are all, you know, the employment categories will be there in this reservation system. So it will include, you know, the shops which employ, right, the certain number of people, then establishment, mines, enterprises, industries, companies, societies, trust, limited liability partnership firms, right? Now, any such firms or any such employment category which employ 10 or more persons. Okay. So any such category which are notified by the government of Jharkhand from time to time, and such categories have employing 10 or more persons, okay, will be included in this, you know, in this Jharkhand State Employment of Local Candidate Bill 2021. Now, most important thing is that all jobs which are having the salary up to 30,000, okay, 75% of the people should belongs to the local Jharkhand. Okay, now every employer need to register employees on the design portal. Okay, now there should be, you know, the registration process on the portal, right? So every employer means who provide, you know, the employment avenue, right, they have to compulsory register all their employees on the portal, right, who are receiving the salary of not more than 30,000 rupees, right? Now this thing has to be done within 3 months of the bill which is coming to the force after being, you know, executed by the government of Jharkhand. Now there is also provision that no candidate will be provided the job if they are not registered in the design portal. That means the registration of a particular employee is compulsory, right, for getting the job. So that is something which is the most essential. Okay, the bill benefits or bill define the local candidate as a person who belongs to the Jharkhand. Okay, and it is registered under the design portal. Okay, so if the person is belong to the local Jharkhand, and if the person is registered under the design portal, okay, such person is eligible to get the benefit under this scheme. Okay, and also if there is not sufficient amount of local candidates available under the desired skill or the proficiency, the employer can take the exemption from the government, okay, that the required candidate is not available. Okay, so this is the map. You can see the Jharkhand, right? Next, the RC, that is, you know, revised cost estimate of the comprehensive scheme for strengthening of the transmission and the distribution in the Arunachal Pradesh and the Sikkim. Okay, now the government of India's move to strengthen the transmission and the distribution in the Arunachal Pradesh and the Sikkim state, which is the northeastern states, right? Now, the Union Cabinet have approved the revised cost estimate of, you know, providing the transmission and the distribution specifically in the state of Arunachal Pradesh and the Sikkim with the cost of 9,129 crore. A comprehensive scheme was planned. Now, this scheme would be implemented first of all by the Power Grid, right, which is a public sector undertaking under the Ministry of Power. It will be implemented in association with the Sikkim and the Arunachal Pradesh government or their power distribution companies. Okay, this scheme was initially approved in December 2014, right, as a central sector plan. So it was initially as a central sector plan, okay, of the Ministry of Power, and entire cost of implementation of such project will be borne by the government of India, and it will be taken from the budget outlay or the plan scheme of the Ministry of Power. Okay, now it is targeted to be commissioned in the phased manner by, you know, by the December 2021. Okay, after commissioning, okay, now the transmission and the distribution system which are created will be owned and maintained by the respective state utilities. Okay, now it is a major step towards strengthening of, you know, the economic development, right, the power distribution, the transmission infrastructure, specifically the intrastate transmission and the distribution system in the Arunachal Pradesh and the Sikkim state of the northeastern states. Okay, so this is what the transmission cables. Okay, next, the Handicrafts and the Handloom Export Corporation of India. So this is also known as HHEC. So Handicrafts and Handloom Export Corporation of India, it is a public sector undertaking under Ministry of Textile. Okay, now the Union Cabinet has approved the closure of this Handicrafts and the Handloom Export Corporation of India, completely closure, right? That means the government of India want to completely close down this PSU under administrative control of Ministry of Textile, because this PSU is continuously incurring the loss since financial year 2015 and 16, and it is not earning sufficient income, right, to meet its running expenses. Okay, and according to the government, you know, sources, there is a little scope for their revival, and which necessitate the complete closure of this public sector undertaking. Okay, now with that approval, the government exchequer is reduced, right, in terms of the recurring expenditure which will be given in terms of the salaries, wages to those employees who are working in the 6 CPSC, right, and which are not, you know, operation, which are not earning any income, right, and under this, you know, the employees and the management trainees will be provided, you know, the opportunity to avail the voluntary retirement service. Okay, so they can avail such voluntary retirement service as per the norms which are led by the Department of Public Enterprises. Okay, so that's all for the today. So thank you very much, those who attended this session. We will meet again tomorrow for next current affairs. Thank you very much.